Hi, I'm Frank Noscazi. I teach physics, and I think that students learn science best by doing it. Not just like once a year for the science fair, not once a week when we have scheduled lab periods, not once at the beginning of the year in that first unit on scientific method, but all the time. Doing science needs to be part of the backbone and the life of science curriculum. We've heard a lot about STEM education, science, technology, education, science, technology, engineering, and math, and that it's really critical for things like competitiveness in a global economy. It's critical for having scientific literate citizens. It's critical for making informed policy decisions. And those are all really good things, but the problem is that what I see scientists do and what I see our students do is not the same thing. So scientists, they create, they explore, they discover, they reason. But what are our students doing? They're consuming instead of creating. They're watching instead of exploring, verifying instead of discovering, and recalling instead of reasoning. And that's a problem. And not only that, but we think that teaching is explaining, and it's not. So not only are we not doing what scientists do, but we're also teaching our kids in a way that they don't learn best. Instead, teaching is more about creating experiences for constructing their own meaning. But yet, we still fill our kids' heads with formulas and equations and vocabulary and try to stuff it all in there, and then it winds up leaking out of their noses and their ears anyway. And it gives them this feeling that science is this thing that was handed down from dead white guys, and that they can't do it, and that they can't participate in it. And it's not something for them, and it's only for the smart kids. And it really shouldn't be like that. Richard Feynman, a great physicist, and actually a brilliant lecturer, he even came to the conclusion that what I cannot create, I do not understand. And we need to get kids in that creative process in science class. So one way to do that is with a program that I use called Modeling Instruction in Science. And Modeling Instruction in Science is a way where we, instead of relying on textbooks and lectures, we actively engage the kids in creating and designing their own experiments to find out how the physical world works. And I did lie a little bit. We do use textbooks. They make a great way to prop up the tables for ramps. The modeling cycle has three stages. And the first stage is model development. That's where the kids come. And instead of doing the lab like in a traditional classroom, you might do the lab at the end. So you would have this great lecture, maybe send them home to watch a video about some science concept, and then they do the lab to solidify and cement and verify the concepts that they watched you teach or watched in the video. What with modeling instruction is we kind of flip that around and have the lab come first, where the kids use the lab experience to create and come up with the content themselves. So the first step is model deployment, development, then model deployment, and then model failure. So in the model development phase, we first observe and experiment. So we give the kids some kind of really simple scenario. And in this case, it's this little toy-operated buggy. And it moves at a constant speed. And we say, what could we observe about that buggy? What could we measure? What could we change? What variables can we find the relationship between? Just like scientists would be questioning things about their world. And then the kids design their own experiment around their questions from their observations. And it's not just this cookbook predetermined regimen recipe that they have to follow with a data table that they have to fill out. It's they design their own experiment. They decide how they're going to take the data, how much data they're going to take, how they're going to analyze it. So it's all student created. We're getting them involved in that scientific process. And then once they've got their data, they go and they construct a model. One way to do that would be with a graph. So these kids decided to graph their data for a fast buggy and a slow buggy. And you see that they get two straight lines, and there's an equation and a data table. And that's great. So now they're coming up with some of the rules for how that buggy works in terms of its motion. But then here's the really critical part, is that they share their results to the class as a scientific community. So rather than like in a traditional science lab, the kids do this lab to verify some equation that they already know, that the teacher already knows, and then that gets turned in only for the teacher to see. So here, we are working together as a community and we're sharing our results out. And I use these whiteboards, which are great. We use them for a lot of different things. And now that we have different groups with different data and different whiteboards, we could say, well, what's different about your graph than her graph? And why did that group get a different slope than your group? And even though they have different slopes, what's the same about everything? And then we could kind of come and generalize and come to a consensus as a community about what the model is and how the principle that they're studying works. Once they've got that, then we go into model deployment. And this is your typical, we do some problem solving, just like regular class does. We do some regular textbook problems, could kind of help get them in the mode for that. But what's really different is the whole concept of multiple representations. So in this example of some student work, the kids solved a problem and they represented it 5 different ways. They've got the equation, they've got a motion diagram, they've got a velocity graph, they've got a position graph, they've got a table. And this multiple representation is great because it gives kids multiple footholds into the content. So if they are weak in kind of one representation, they could still answer the problem using a different representation. And by also having that multiple representations, we're stretching their brains out in different directions and getting them to see the same concept from a variety of angles. And they learn the concepts in a much deeper way rather than a superficial way. The other thing that we do is make predictions. And these kids, boom, they got it. What they were supposed to do was predict where those two buggies that are going at different speeds would collide in the middle. So that's that, you know, that famous one train leaves New York, the other train leaves LA, where are they going to meet? So here it is brought to life using the data and the equations and the concepts that they learned in the model development phase. And now they're using it here, and they actually had to predict. They were not allowed to play with them beforehand. I said, okay, your buggies are going to start 3 meters apart. Your another group's going to start them 4 meters apart. Where are they going to collide? And they marked that tape down, and they got really close, and the sound of the kids going, yeah, and they high-five each other. It's like this great feeling, you know? Kids need to high-five each other more in science class. And we also try to do authentic problems whenever we can. So I pose to the kids, is there a speeding problem in front of the school? So what data are you going to take? How does that apply to the model that we just did? So we went out in front of the school, they took some data, some kids took video, and now they have to argue about whether there's a speeding problem or not. And then there's a whole issue with what is speeding anyway? Is it one car that goes 80 miles an hour instead of the 35 mile an hour speed limit? Is it a whole, so there's a whole bunch of reasoning going on there too. So that was really a lot of fun. And then comes model failure.